Good morning, everybody. Welcome to The Blueprint, Selling Leaders on Cybersecurity and Business Continuity Investment. My name is Mike Dealey. I'm the Information Security Officer for Viewpoint. And along with me today is Anne Hunt. Anne?
Thanks, everyone, for attending our session. I'm Anne Hunt, the Director of Data and Analytics. I manage the incubation team where we're understanding what data can do for us. Let's start with our legal disclaimer. The information you are about to receive outlines our general direction. It is not a commitment and should not be relied upon when making a decision. The development, release, and timing is a Viewpoint decision. So please take some time to read this. There is a joke in it, so I'll know if you read it. Viewpoint one, this is our offering and suite. It's from the back office to the field, time entry into payroll, document and drawing sharings, employment onboarding. Viewpoint one makes it easy to put data in, understand your information from anywhere and any device. During this session, feel free to chat in the Q&A, even collaborate with other session attendees. Feel free to get to know each other. And these questions that are submitted will be answered at the end of our session. Need CPE credits? Look for the survey link at the end. We'll also remind you of this at the end. This is how we know you have attended the entire session.
Thanks, Anne. Great job on the intro. So today we're going to get into the content here in a few minutes, but I'm going to go over objectives and agenda this morning first. So our session today is going to explore cybersecurity risks for construction companies, what to focus on and what to avoid. Key areas include a discussion about establishing priorities through assigning value to data, challenges of a mobile workforce with potentially high personnel turnover, and third-party risk associated with collaborative data sharing outside of your company. So gambling with cyber risk. I'm going to give you an analogy with this slide. So who doesn't love summertime and fresh ripe fruit? We know that cyber criminals are like fruit flies in the sense that they like your data analogous to the fresh fruit. So BIM data, PII, PHI, your job site photos, your blueprints, all of these things that you're putting into these tools, they have a lot of valuable data, and there's a lot of value to that data for any sort of threat actor. So who here likes to gamble? How far are you willing to go? How much risk are you willing to take with your business data? So failure to address cybersecurity threats increases your exposure to a host of risks. Your brand equity, the bottom line. What about negative press? It's commonplace these days in relation to publicized cybersecurity incidents. It causes reputational damage and it's hard to recover from, not to mention unplanned costs and decreasing your company's market valuation. So Anne, what can be a catalyst for cybersecurity increase?
As you all probably are aware, COVID has impacted the way we've worked. It has forced all of us to start working remotely, and this has changed how our business is operating. Ultimately, this is where we created dependencies by working from home, and these dependencies create opportunities for ransomware attacks. And during COVID, we've seen huge spikes in ransomware attacks, from 148%, and this varies from week to week. However, some outliers are reporting fewer successful attacks. But what can we do about this, and how do we start to make sure we're ready for attacks?
This slide sort of illustrates a few things, right? These are construction companies, publicly traded, large companies that have actually been hit by ransomware and been significantly impacted. And so the question I ask you is, have you had a conversation internal with your company and your colleagues about whether you're going to pay and under what circumstances if you were to be hit with ransomware? So, for example, Canadian firm Bird Construction was a victim of Maze, $9 million ransom for only 60 gigs, as just another example. This happens all the time. It is a business. These threat actors actually profit, and some have even retired from doing this work. So it's up to all of us to make sure that we're focusing on we have the foundational aspects in place to ensure that we have security controls that help prevent this. Other companies are getting attacked and they have to adapt. And to make that case we're all at risk, we've got a short video clip here for you from a couple of our customers.
Hey, this can happen to anyone. It's not just, hey, we're too small or nobody cares about our data. you know, as Craig will talk about later, they don't care about who you are. They just care that you're going to pay the ransom.
So as you heard from the video clip and our customer panelists, ransomware has a serious impact on the business. Many aspects from business efficiency, the bottom line, recovery costs, et cetera. And as you can see from the slide, the costs are only increasing every year, both exponentially from a occurrence perspective as well as a cost perspective. So Anne, what is Viewpoint seeing with the use of data?
Thanks, Mike. As you can see, you guys have a ton of valuable information in your ERP system. You probably don't even know what's all in there, but think about how you handle your information, because just like cybersecurity, they could potentially find that information before you do. Maybe there's a field that was created with social security numbers. You really want to make sure you're digging into your information and know what's valuable, making sure you have processes around this. Inventory your data. What is the impact if someone else finds your valuable data? Mike, could you dive into this?
Sure. So think about an analogy here. You've got bags of cash that you stuff in your mattress, right? The fact of the matter is that they're going to find your assets in terms of data if given enough time. And you have to essentially wrap defense in depth around security controls such that you have adequate protection. So imagine this, 60% of you attending today's presentation were out of business within 6 months after a cyber attack. That's what we're seeing. We're seeing small and medium businesses go out of business after a cyber attack. And it's a big impact to your company, potentially. So Anne, what is your opinion on whether you invest now or later?
Thanks, Mike. Can you afford not to invest? The question is really whether you're going to pay now or pay later. Paying later means that you weren't prepared for the attack and you're held to whatever standards they're looking for in order to get your business up and running again. But if you start to invest now and get some policies and processes in place, you're setting yourself up for success. You're creating an insurance that you're ready for them. You don't want to be in a position where you're forced to pay out money despite companies understanding the increasing risk. 70% of companies aren't adequately prepared. So this is a huge portion. So how can we start to think about what we can do to help you? As a company, how many security personnel do you have? Is it one person, 10 people, hundreds? Or is it that IT handles this information? Let's hear from you guys. Start putting some answers in the chat. But as you can see, it's really that this is a company-wide endeavor. Everyone should hold a component within your security. Your HR manages records. This information is really highly secure. Even your mobile workforce is important. So let's dive into some of this. What is cybersecurity? What are the three kind of pyramids within that? So cybersecurity combines technology, people, and process to create strategies aimed at protecting sensitive data, ensuring business continuity, and safeguarding against financial loss. So what does confidentiality mean? It means that it's defining the rules that limit the access of the PII information, that personally identified information. And it's even further than that. It's really making sure you're securing that information. Confidentiality takes on measures to restrict the sensitive information from being accessed by cybersecurity attackers. Moving on to integrity. Integrity means that the data is consistent, accurate, and trustworthy over a period of time. It means that the data within it should not be changed, altered, deleted, or illegally being accessed. And then lastly, availability in terms of necessary components like hardware, software, networks. Devices and security equipment should be maintained and upgraded. Now, even if you have the systems in place, you need to monitor and check them. So these are the three kind of pillars into cybersecurity. Getting into what happens if you do have an attack. You know, all press is good press, right? Well, cybersecurity, it can even get into some things that we've never even thought about, like design and blueprints. Typically, we think about PII as employee data, financial data, passwords, having MFA to help us with that. But there's a case when a non-sensitive data element had a breach. They were on the job site and a hacker went into the blueprint and changed one metric. And look at this complex bridge. How would you know if this was right or wrong? And they were held for ransomware until they paid the money to understand what happened. So even design elements are really important because now you're structurally could change the bridge. So this is really important, and you could have a legal problem here. So did you know that one common catalyst for a security breach is phishing attacks? This is actually the most common type of attack. Mike, what is important to understand about phishing attacks?
Thanks, Sam. That's a really good job on explaining the pillars of cybersecurity. It's valuable. Thank you. So phishing is still, yes, one of the number one tactics that people are gaining access into systems. So here's an example in the slide of a common attack where scammers pretend to be affiliated with the recipient's employer. These folks are getting a lot better and more accurate at making it harder to perceive phishing. They're also extrapolating out to text messages and vishing. What's vishing? Vishing is when you actually get a voice call that is essentially sampling somebody's voice that you know, and then making a voice recording of it, telling you to do something. So it basically helps, it helps them be successful by persuading you to take an action based on some sort of urgent request by somebody usually in power, like an executive. So have you had a conversation within your company about whether you'll pay a ransom? It's an important conversation to have at a senior level so that you understand where and when and if you'll pay. Oftentimes companies will even pay and then they don't get all of their data decrypted. So it's something you should consider and take seriously. So in your company, who's responsible for security? Reiterating Anne's earlier point, the answer really should be everyone. It's a consolidated effort. Everybody needs to be involved. Security is a business problem. It's everybody's problem. And it needs to have some focus and attention from everybody. You're thinking about security all the time, and it makes your life easier. So what can phishing lead to? We already talked about ransomware. Here's a slide that tells you the attack vector by variant. RDP exposed to the internet and phishing are two keys to successful exploitation. Deploying multi-factor authentication on every system and application that you possibly can helps reduce that risk exposure. So here's another slide that basically depicts some aspect of the financial impact. So 7.3 days, average number of days that the ransomware attack can last, and the average cost around $65,000. This obviously goes up depending on what you're including in that figure. Are you including all your efforts towards containment only? What about eradication? What about remediation? What about getting the business back up and running? This is a small slice of the pie in terms of the overall cost. And what about your business your lost business? So for example, if you're a manufacturing company, how much time have you lost if your assembly line goes down, right? How much, you need to quantify that so you understand what the real business impact is from a financial perspective. What happens if you can't have your mobile workforce actively doing their jobs for a week? How much does that cost you? So it's something you should consider and figure out what your own number might be so that you really truly understand how to offset that with your investments in security.
Let's hear from some customers on their perspective of the disruption of being attacked.
I also know that even though if you're only down for a couple of days or a week, the total time of disruption on average is 45 days. And so it sounds like, I mean, Craig, yes, they got through pretty quickly in a couple of days and it was hell, but there's been a long-term impact, a lot of additional things. And so we want people to understand that it's scary to get ransomware and it's scary to get hacked and it can make you better, but it's extremely disruptive to your business. And that's the danger we're trying to prevent. We don't want our companies, especially in construction, where we're very sensitive to work and cash flow and things like that, it's really important that we try to keep the lights on, you know, as much as possible. So I want people to hear that the disruption is, there's sort of the immediate disruption of the event, and then there's the longer term, what should we be doing? And Craig is describing what changes they've made, which is awesome, but that's what's going to happen. That's the pattern, right? So it's kind of like, if you do that stuff ahead of time a little bit, maybe you can prevent some of that future disruption. Either way, you have to deal with it, right? It's kind of like the timing. Do you want to, like that old mechanics commercial, do you want to pay me now or do you want to pay me later, right? So it's kind of one of those deals.
So as we heard, this is resonating to hear about how the disruption is longer than just the 7 days. It could be long-term that you're finding missing data, as Mike has mentioned, or even the cost of disruption that it takes your business down and your focus on getting your business back up and running versus running the business. So let's get into discussion about business continuity and risk remediation tactics. So Mike's going to walk us through some examples.
Thanks, Anne. So let's talk a little bit about your business continuity plan. So if you look at the first item here, does your company have the capability to monitor for inappropriate use and other security events that might arise? This is really important. You can be logging a ton of data and having it go into a SIM, or maybe it's not going anywhere and it's just overwriting itself. The problem is you may not know day one when a threat actor gets into your system. You may actually need to retroactively go look at those logs and look for forensic data. So you need to make sure that you're monitoring appropriately and that you're alerting, and you're only alerting on things that are actionable. Second, do you have a documented or formal policy regarding use of company networks and how you address data? In other words, do you train your employees about the risk of data exposure and what their individual responsibilities are? It's really important because the human element is really the lowest common denominator. Third, what about access to critical systems? Is it only limited to the people that need a reason to have access to those systems? It's called least privilege and role-based access control. It's really important. Finally, have your employees been trained on how to avoid exploits, avoid being suckered into phishing attempts? What about other malicious activity on your network and how to report that type of activity? If you can, set up a centralized phone number and or email address so that people have, and then train your staff so that they have a way to report these types of activities.
These are good points, Mike. A security maturity model is a set of characteristics or indicators that represent capability and progression with an organization's program. Where do you sit on this spectrum? Is it reactive? Is it proactive? Are you adjusting your cybersecurity strategic roadmap accordingly? Data breaches have a funny way of forcing organizations to move from one vertical to the next. It really makes sure they're taking the right approaches. But do you want to be forced to move, or are you going to do it yourself and make these changes? Ultimately, we all want to be on that proactive side. You have a decision to make today. What is your target and how long will it take you to get there? Can you start putting in simple processes such as MFA, your technology, your hardware is up to date? Those are some things to think about. How do you prepare? Where does your data live? It's imperative for construction companies to take inventory of this data. Know exactly what information you have. Where is it stored? Who exactly has access to this information? This is important to understand if the right people have the right access, because you don't want to ensure that something gets out because somebody had the wrong access. For the construction industry, constant connectivity is a necessity. Job sites, base camps are all set up with workers getting handed portable devices, which could be exposing sensitive data. For example, who uses mobile devices on a job site? Do you require MFA and passwords for them to access it? And employees are constantly changing roles. So these are some things to think about when you start enabling security in your business. Let's dive into three areas: mobile workforce, file sharing, and high personal turnover. It's important to have policies that require passwords and other validation, while mobile devices should be assured for vulnerability. Employee turnover. Even within the company, there can be high turnover and reliance on subcontractors, making it difficult to arrange and deliver uniform IT and cybersecurity. So it's important to ensure that these policies are continuously managed and set out to all employees. Just like your seatbelt, it always is there and annoying. This is kind of how cybersecurity is. File sharing can introduce risks of malware infection. Again, as we talked about, phishing attacks are on the rise. So always be sure of this and send out reminders to your employees, especially those new employees. So what can you do as a business? Identify your company's most valuable information and where that information is located on your network. Establish internal controls and cybersecurity protocols, which consider both internal and external threats. Prioritize cybersecurity procedures to protect the most valuable information. You need to place the highest levels of protection around your most valuable information. On a regular basis, evaluate your cybersecurity controls and procedures. This is always a constantly evolving state, and make sure you just continue to manage your business in small incremental ways. So, Mike, can you establish some muscle memories that we could help with?
And those are really great points. Thanks for sharing. Sure. So let's talk about a few of these in detail, right? The key point here is to get people to slow down. In our society these days, everybody's trying to go as fast as possible and be as efficient as possible. However, the problem with that is that oftentimes we click before we think, and really what we need to foster is the attitude of stop, slow down, think before you click. Have employees report phishing emails and anything else that's suspicious. I mentioned this earlier, and you need to really establish some way that's central for people to actually make sure that they get the notification to the right person that they think that there's an issue with security. So there's other things you can do that are more technical, and I'm not going to get into all of these in detail, but there are lots of technological solutions that can help you with this. Layer 7 firewalls, intrusion detection systems, URL filtering, et cetera. Of course, looking for ransomware and malware on your systems to make sure that you're trying to prevent that from happening. Establish strong password policies, roll out MFA or multi-factor authentication, and absolutely deploy a secure password management solution for all employees. This is kind of a fun point here because this is how you can add value from a security perspective. So let's say that you don't necessarily have every application centralized and using Active Directory for authentication as an example. There are tools out there. One that we use here at Viewpoint is called LastPass, and that's essentially a password management tool to keep employees from storing passwords on Post-its or writing it on their hand, or perhaps even storing it in a browser. LastPass is a secure tool where you can store all your passwords. You can even share passwords among colleagues. And that way you're not writing these things down and making it easier for people to gain access to them.
Thanks, Frank. I think that's a great point. You know, I know even myself, I don't change my passwords often enough. And so having a place to manage those is really important, because otherwise we continue to use the same password, which is high risk, because eventually those algorithms are going to figure out what password and have access to all of your accounts. And now imagine your problem at hand.
And
so let's get into some.
Like, if I can interject for a moment, has the password manager made your life simpler?
Oh, it's made it a lot easier for me, because otherwise, yeah, I'm writing it down in a notebook, and this way my passwords are better, higher security, because I don't have to remember them, and it puts it into the browser or whatever application I need to have them. But the key is for LastPass, don't forget that password. And also remember to change it. Ransomware and defensive tactics. Really, this is taking education to all levels of the organization, making sure your in-mobile workforce has knowledge and information all the way up to your executive suite, making sure they all get buy-in and understanding. As we've heard numerous times in this presentation, it takes an entire organization to make sure you are secure. Limit the use of private information to only those that need it. This limits your risk. Avoid using RDPs without properly terminating the session. Disable unnecessary share folders so that even in the event of ransom attacks, it's prevented from moving laterally across the network. This is similar to those passwords. If you have one password that accesses the entire kingdom, well, that would be a problem. Disable macros across the environment. Apply attempting filters to your emails. Phishing emails are one of the biggest components of attacks. So let's make sure, how do we sell this to executive levels? What are some tactics you guys could use so that your organization all buys in? Security all costs money. So how do you get your executives to buy in and invest? Mike, can you give us some tips on this?
Sure, Anne. Thanks. So again, who's ultimately responsible for cybersecurity in your organization? You've got to look in the mirror. It's all of us again. It takes a village to be successful at this. It's a cultural aspect that you have to work to change in a lot of companies, to drive the ownership and accountability to the business leaders by establishing valuable metrics, both tactical and strategic, and track the historical progress over time so you know if it's working. So what if a threat actor exfiltrated your proprietary bidding model and sold it to your competitors, or stole bank account credentials to conduct successful fraudulent transactions? It's really important in terms of business continuity that you play the what if game. So what do I mean by that? I mean, establish all of the possibilities that you can think that may go wrong, may cause business disruption, may cause a security breach or security incident, and figure out defensive tactics that you can apply in each of those scenarios such that you have a solid defense in depth strategy. So let me give you an example. So at Viewpoint, what I did is I went and I had interviews with all the executives, and I asked them, what is valuable to you from a security perspective? What keeps you up at night from a security perspective? And then I tabulated all that data and I looked for patterns. The pattern was that customers' data is the most important thing to our executive staff, which is exactly correct. Your data is what we should be looking to protect at all times. So if you have the conversation, for example, around ransomware and whether you'd pay or not, that's an example of one scenario. Would your business be able to recover and remain competitive after a breach? That's another aspect to your use cases that you should consider. The goal here is to protect the crown jewels. You've got to ask yourself every day whether you're focused on the right thing. You've got to build confidence with your business leadership by selling them that you understand what the value of this data is while being fiscally prudent. So how? I mentioned earlier that I conducted interviews. Additionally, you need to think about what you're doing today. Is it going to provide the most value in terms of risk reduction? This is the critical question that you should get tired of asking yourself until it's routine. And also, you want to perpetuate that same sort of approach to other business leaders from a security perspective. Security is, like I said earlier, it's just a business problem, and you solve it the same way as any other business problem. You've got to do your discovery, you've got to analyze the data, you've got to figure out your ROI, and make sure that you understand what makes the most sense in terms of protecting your crown jewels, and ask yourself whether or not, if I'm doing X today, is that really the most bang for the buck? And if it's not, course correct and adjust. That's what's going to help build confidence with your executive staff. So hold on. Is this a trap? It's a completely reasonable question, right? So if we think about this, how are you going to really find out whether the top four companies in your vertical spend on cybersecurity and how it's allocated? It's going to be difficult. You're not. But that's not the spirit of the question. It's a contextual question about reasonableness, a reasonable level of risk acceptance and spend, right? Executives these days are essentially real-time gamblers. They're given imperfect data and they have to make very quick decisions without all of the data. I know for me, that's really hard because I'm a data-driven person. I'm sure Ann can appreciate this. I like to have all the data so I can make a very well thought out decision. But at the end of the day, you can't always do that. You have to take snippets of data, stitch them together so that you have a reasonable expectation or outcome based on your action. And so you can't necessarily prepare real world security posture without knowing these three things: where your company stands in relation to your industry peers. But as I said, that's not easy to do. So you do the best you can. There is data out there for particular verticals. For example, you can go get data from the IBM Ponymon report. You can go get the Verizon data breach incident report. Both of those come out annually, and you can get a lot of really good insights from those documents. They're free. You can go get those off the internet. And then you can look at that data and you can understand, really, generally speaking, where you compare. You can figure out what the record cost is per year. And then you can do some correlation to understand if you actually lost sensitive data, how much would it really cost you? And you can forecast based on that analysis. What about your defenses and whether or not they've improved over time? You need to be looking at that so that you understand whether or not you're making progress, and break that down by business unit. So for example, at Viewpoint, we look at that based on business unit. So we analyze that based on finance, based on product development. We look at IT, we look at HR, we look at all these other company or other these stakeholders within the company and figure out who needs to course correct and when and how fast. All of these things, if you provide that visibility, helps your program, helps you reduce risk, and helps build confidence with your exec staff. It also helps you understand what emerging threats potentially in your business are rising or falling. So in other words, context is everything. You also need to go do the math. Remember, responsible frugality breeds confidence. If you're the CISO or the one in charge for security, you have to understand how much you're spending, you have to understand the risk, and then you've got to convert that into a language the C-suite understands, which is the language of money. It's not easy, especially if you're someone who may be in charge of IT, you're a technical person, maybe you don't have all the business acumen that you, like if somebody with an MBA does. The bottom line is, it doesn't matter. You have to figure out how to bridge that gap. That's your job. So the key to that is going and asking questions, asking for feedback. What is working? What isn't working? Have some humility. It actually makes a difference. At the end of the day, you break down those barriers and you understand what each of the executives is targeting, what they feel is important and what they're after and the method of communication that they prefer. And then you tailor your messaging for that. That's how you get more confidence and more investment. So, have you solved everything in your environment that you can with a manual process and policy? That's another big win. So in other words, before you go ask for spending more money on a tool, for example, have you done everything you can to contain the human element? Have you gone out in your ecosystem and your environment and looked for all the risks that you can simply solve by writing a process or policy document? Because look, at the end of the day, people in the absence of a directive will find a way to solve the problem. That's what we do. That's human nature. So you will have 60 people in your environment solving things 60 different ways if you don't give them a methodology. So the key here is, if you have certain risks, in many cases, you can spend time spending literally no money by simply going and doing education, established standards, established process and policy, and then enforce it. Do compliance on it. Make sure that you can measure it such that you know if you're making progress.
These are great tips, Mike. It's also important that you have somebody in your organization that really is the champion of your security. So think about hiring a security person to help embrace and bring energy around this topic so that they can sell to that executive level or even throughout the organization to your employees, continuously monitoring and bringing that to the front of mind. You could start with hiring an intern and getting them to create some policies and practice, and potentially even hire them later. Viewpoint can help as well. We have a managed cloud team, and Mike will kind of dive into and explain here what else Viewpoint has. Mike, can you explain what Viewpoint has to offer?
Sure, Anne, that's a great point. So let me start by saying Viewpoint, in terms of our SaaS cloud platform offerings, we actually have several things going on behind the scenes. Besides just your standard customer support team, with many of you engaged and interact with, we have escalation points within those teams. And we also have a cloud operations team that fundamentally manages all of the platform. These are the people that are doing all the patching, making sure that the systems are all up and available for your use. In addition to that, we also have a 24/7, 365 security operations center. These are dedicated people that are watching security controls and alerts and monitoring all of those different environments, and then taking action on those in real time if there are any deviations. We've sunk a large investment into various certifications like SOC, ISO and TrustArc privacy shield certifications. These are a lot of security controls that help us manage and maintain the levels of security that your data deserves.
I even know that when I request data, that Mike makes sure that I have the right access. It can be challenging as an organization to not get that information as quickly as you'd like, but you're making sure it is secure.
So another thing you can consider is cybersecurity insurance. There are a lot of various different policies, so loop in your counsel for guidance. So key takeaways. What I can urge you to do is start now. There's no time like the present, and the sooner you address this, the sooner you get rid of the blind spots that you may have. You've got to be able to adapt quickly so that your business can absorb it. Start with small incremental enhancements, active patching, monitoring, alerting, training your employees. Many of these things that I've mentioned previously, they're all really critical and they don't necessarily cost a lot of money. Start with applications that benefit staff while simultaneously providing you more telemetry and visibility. So for example, I'm going to refer back to our LastPass. Think of that as a tool that helps your employees go faster, but doing so while being more secure. That's what I'm talking about. You may think about an MDM or MAM solution, which is simply a way to manage your email in a secure fashion if you're on a mobile device. Again, a lot of those tools can actually enhance staff's ability to be efficient and at the same time provide more security to your data. And finally, build confidence with your C-suite by acting as an interpreter. You've got to be able to convert the language of cybersecurity into tactical risk and compare that from dollars spent versus dollars averted.
I know you are all excited now to get back into security and start creating some policies. Before we finish, though, I want to remind everyone that there's some great customer success resources designed to help you succeed and get the most out of your Viewpoint One solution. There's the Viewpoint Customer Portal for support, troubleshooting, and knowledge resources. There's the Viewpoint Academy for role-based training, instructor-led classes, and certification programs. And lastly, there's the Viewpoint Network, where you can connect with other people in the community, a great place for you and your peers. And now let's hear about Collaborate. Your experience here at Collaborate has been great, and we want to remind you to take that survey for your CPE credits, earn badges, and participate along the way. So thanks again for joining our session. Now let's go answer your questions in the chat. Thanks everyone for being very active in the chat. And now we're going to get to those questions. So we're going to start with at the top, what cybersecurity risks do we have if we use the Viewpoint One cloud service? Mike, can you help us out there?
Sure. So we're SOC 2 Type 2 certified for all of our Viewpoint One products. And then we also have SOC 1 Type 2 for our ERP solutions, Vista and Spectrum. Obviously, there's a lot of security controls around ascertaining those certifications. So are the risks all there still, whether you're on-prem or in the cloud? Absolutely. The difference really is you've got a partner who's looking at looking out for you and all of your customer data. And we have our security operations center, again, as I mentioned, that is 24/7, 365 to help with all of those alerts and monitoring and triage as necessary. So again, the risks are all there. It's just a matter of you have additional help rather than having to go source that yourself or hire, say, a third party monitoring company.
Perfect. We're gonna move on to the next question that we got. Viewpoint needs to do more to obscure on-screen data such as personal bank account info on the PR employee screen and only display if the user toggles off the obscuring during the view. Vista 6/19/15. Mike, can you give us some more insights into that?
Sure. So I actually have heard a similar request about this before, and I've actually submitted that to our product team as a feature request. I will take this this request as well, and I will funnel that through our internal process and make sure that the product person in charge of Vista definitely hears about this. I agree. It'd be nice to be able to have have those features available. And you know, the other thing too is role-based access control and obfuscation. So for example, maybe you have a particular role within your company that does a particular aspect of, or function within the ERP platform, and maybe you only want that person to see the last four of the SSN as an example, whereas other people with different roles may need to see the full SSN. So absolutely great question, and we will address that and get back to you.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. We got another question here for you, Mike, from Ed. What is the difference from Viewpoint and Viewpoint One with this security?
Sorry, Anne, can you repeat that?
Yes, this question came in from Ed. What is the difference from Viewpoint and Viewpoint One with this security?
I'm not sure I understand that question, to be honest with you.
Maybe it's the different product names, but yeah, ultimately all of our security.
Maybe we can get some clarification on that and circle back to it.
Cool. Okay, and then a question came in from Todd Park. How does Viewpoint protect data with third-party integration?
Right, it's a great question. So we actually have an initiative in flight right now to address this very issue. It's something that we value and find important both from a security and privacy perspective. So for our VSIP program, where we actually are officially partnering with certain integrators, we do perform due diligence on those vendors to some extent. Obviously, there's contractual language in those contracts that stipulates requirements around security. However, at the end of the day, it's still a matter of responsibility is shared, right? Both between the customer as well as the third-party integrator and Viewpoint.
Perfect. Yes, it takes both sides to really make sure it's secured, because even if Viewpoint secures it, once you guys have it in your data center or into your employees' hands, again, those mobile workforces employees potentially, that's where you need to have some security policies as well. What is the policy you recommend to implement if we are just starting our security journey?
I would say probably acceptable use, essentially laying the foundational bricks, if you will, to make sure that everybody on your staff knows what is okay and what isn't okay in terms of what they can and can't do or should or shouldn't do in relation to traffic on the company's network or certain applications or usage on endpoints that they manage and provide for the staff. So it's really about just sort of making sure that everybody understands what the ground rules are. For example, everybody knows it's illegal to speed, right? Doesn't mean some people don't do it, but the point is everybody knows that if they get caught speeding, there is a consequence. So essentially it's the same idea. It's just making sure that, you know, you have a fair but reasonable set of usage requirements and that everybody knows what that means and the responsibility that's associated with it.
Great, thanks for that insight. What criteria should I use to quantify the value of data?
Right, that's a good question too. So for example, what we use at Viewpoint for data classification is the NIST 853 and the FIPS 199 framework. So in a sense, what we have is four levels of value for data. Customer data would be the highest at restricted. And basically what that means is that that's the most sensitive data, the most valuable data. And then there are more controls associated with, and we're training around handling of that data than there are with lower levels.
Perfect. Have you had any customer experience, any hacker issues with Viewpoint? Do you have any insights into that, Mike?
So if I understand the question correctly, to rephrase it, we're asking whether or not we've had any threat actors attack Viewpoint.
Correct.
Sure. I mean, obviously with our monitoring, we see, you know, with our WAF solution as well as, DDoS type tooling, et cetera, we see attempts quite frequently, just like most businesses do. And I think the key here is defense in depth and making sure that we have enough layers around that data classification layers and that important data to ensure that we've got the alerting and the alerting is actionable. So we do have a classification system, if you will, security events, security incidents, and of course, a breach would be beyond that reportable. It's a situation where we look at all those events and our SOC, as I mentioned earlier, basically vets any of those threats real time. And if anything is, you know, discovered that isn't a false positive or something of that nature, after they filter those out, they escalate internally to our security incident response team, who then takes over and looks at triaging those type of situations.
Perfect. Yes. So that was from Sean, that question. So that was a good point on how Viewpoint really manages the systems. And it is good from that C-suite level, how we are seeing those attacks and the value of having that security. So that's one way to scale to your C-suite. Is there any way to secure the SSN and bank account information from the SQL queries?
Yes, although if you're referring to a specific product, if this is a product-centric question, then I would need to get you with our product folks to get you a more specific answer.
Perfect. Yes, we've seen a few different questions here. One just came in from Martin about, you know, what's the difference between the security in Vista and Viewpoint One? Maybe focus on Viewpoint One and what security that offers.
Right. So Viewpoint One, Vista is a Viewpoint One product, falls underneath that umbrella. So essentially, it's still under the same scrutiny in relation to SOC, right, as well as all the rest of the Viewpoint One products.
Yeah, and do you just want to review again what certificates and security levels each of those systems have? So Vista, isn't it SOC 2 compliant?
Yeah, Vista has SOC 1 Type 2, which is the financial controls reporting piece for publicly traded companies. Basically, what that means, SOC 1 is, you know, what security controls exist in the application itself, and do they work, right? And then outside of that, really, we're talking about SOC 2 Type 2, which is all of the parameters around security controls.
Perfect. That's great. Yeah. Keep going. We're getting lots of questions in the chat, so keep them coming, and we're going to keep trying to answer all of them. But if we don't get to all of your questions, we'll follow up in that. And all this content will be available on Monday, the 28th, where you can see the slides and content. And the CPE yep. link was put into the chat, so remember to take that if you want those CPE credits. And Seth will post it again. Sometimes it gets lost. Oh, there it goes. So you can take that when you want. Okay. You mentioned low-hanging fruit in the session. Can you give us some examples of things we can accomplish with security without spending money?
Sure. Usually this is around process, establishing standards, establishing certain policies like we talked about acceptable use earlier. It's really essentially defining or drawing lines in the sand again and to figure out how you're going to address particular use cases. So essentially understanding, it's important to understand all of your different use cases that potentially have a security ramification, which most do, some more so than others for sure, and then figuring out a prioritization in association with those and going after, you know, the ones that offer the most value any given day. Like I mentioned in the seminar or the session, that you really have to ask yourself again, am I focusing on the right thing every day? And so these constantly shift. But the idea here is if you have a certain standard that you can implement and a process around that standard and associated policy for compliance, if it's violated, that helps drive consistent, you know, behavior with that particular control.
Perfect. That's really helpful. So if a company has several workers rotating through the job site that end up sharing tablets, what's the best way to secure the tablets by ensuring my crew doesn't lose efficiency?
Yeah, this is a hard one. And certainly a lot of people that are mobile on the job site deal with this on a regular basis. So I am a staunch advocate for, you know, staff in general not leaving laptops and cars as an example. Different use case, I understand. But the point here is you've got to have some sort of plan around whether it be laptops or tablets, et cetera. So what does that mean? You can certainly look at something like a mobile device management solution. You can look at also at companies that offer a mobile application management, which is really just a sandbox on the device that you can nuke if something goes wrong or if it gets stolen or something of that nature. Obviously, with the new tablets, the best case scenario would be the technology with facial recognition, right? That's going to make it fast and easy for most people to set up and multiple people to use. But there are lots of different things here that you can leverage. For example, you can make things easier with YubiKeys, as an example, for multi-factor. There are a lot of things, but it's a hard problem, and usually it takes more than one aspect of the items that I've mentioned and potentially others to actually solidly address this issue. If you can, again, though, not have any data retained on the device, so that if it does get stolen, it's not there for somebody to consume potentially. And encryption, right? And make sure you've got encryption mm-hmm. on the devices.
Yeah. So there was a question about if you aren't using Viewpoint One Identity, and is that capable of selective applications, or is it an all or nothing option? And the answer to that is, you can use different types of logins so that you could require admins to only log in via Viewpoint One and other members via porter login method. So there's some different options, and we'll follow up with all of these questions again or in the Collaborate environment. Feel free to reach out to those different options within the portal and contact Viewpoint people. And again, thanks for attending this session. Remember to take the survey, and thanks all for joining us today.
Great questions. Thanks, everybody.